us for the first time. This is Dream Life Worship Center, where dreams become a reality. Come on, say amen. And we believe that God's placed the dream in your heart. He's placed the deep in your heart. And we believe that life has a way of trying to bury our dreams, bury it under our fears, our pain, our disappointments. But in this house, God resurrects dreams. And in this place, you will learn to dream again. Amen. Matthew 21, this is the story of Jesus' triumphant entry, as we call it, as theologians call it. I want to read from verse 1. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem, they came to Bethany at the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus sent to his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them.' And immediately he will send them." All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion." How many know you're Zion? You're Zion. "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming." The original verse, Zechariah 9, says, "Rejoice greatly. Rejoice greatly and shout because your king is coming." Somebody shout hallelujah. He's coming lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, and the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt and laid their clothes, your Bible may say cloaks, on them and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down the branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out or shouted out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David." Very important, underline that. Son of David. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Somebody shout hallelujah. As all time will allow me to read from Matthew, but if you will, go to Psalms 118, which is the messianic prelude to Matthew 21. It is the prophetic or historical account of Matthew 21. Though it is speaking of David and his coronation, King David's coronation, it is prophetically speaking of the Christ that will come. So if you look at Psalms 118 and look at verse 22, "The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing." Whose doing was it? Whose doing was it? Very important. It was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day. This is what? This is what? The NIV says it like this. The NIV is powerful. It says, "The Lord has done it this very day." Anybody need God to do something this very day? "This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice." We will what? Rejoice. "And be glad in it." Verse 25, "Hosanna," or the New King James says, "save now." Not tomorrow, not next week. Save right now. I pray, O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. Verse 26, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, who we have blessed you from the house of God." Where do we bless him? From the house of God. I want to take my subject from those verses where it says they cried out Hosanna, or they shouted Hosanna. My subject this morning is, why do we shout? Why do we shout? You may be seated. Why do we shout? I know that there are many people today that don't like a lot of noise. Let me tell you, you might have come to the wrong church this morning. Because this is what we label Palm Sunday, and it is a time when we as believers, and let's be very careful, this is the Bible teaching, preaching church, so I need you to follow me. We have labeled this very clearly Palm Sunday. This is what the theologians have penned and have shared, that this is Christ's triumphant entry. into Jerusalem. It is a story, listen to me carefully, of the sovereignty of God. Now, a few weeks ago, the Holy Spirit began to deal with my heart, and he says, I want you to deal more in your church with the sovereignty now. The sovereignty of God. What is the sovereignty of God? If you're taking notes, you can write this down. It is God's supreme rule. His supreme rule and power and authority and control over the affairs of all mankind and the life of his true followers. You hear the expression a lot, God is in control. And then when things happen that seemingly are evil or contrary to the nature of God's goodness, we say, well, if he's in control, how could this have happened? So when we talk about the sovereignty of God, we're not saying that he makes all the decisions for your life and all the decisions that mankind makes. What we are saying is that God, watch this, has the power to carry out all of his purposes and plans in the earth, as well as watch, your life, in spite, here it is, of satanic interference or human intervention. So there's some things that the devil is doing, but it cannot stop the power and plan of God. There's some things you doing. But I got some good news for you. It still cannot stop the plan and power of God that he has predestined for you. Job questioned it one day. One time Job's story, he was going through. He lost his family. He lost his wealth. He lost everything. He even began to lose his health. In 37 chapters, Job is complaining. His friends are trying to give him answers. And then after a while, Job is just really getting upset with God, trying to figure out why is God allowing this to happen. And then finally in chapter 38, the Bible says the Lord answered him. I guess God was sitting in heaven saying, I can't stand no more. So he answers Job out of a whirlwind, and he says, Who is this whose darkness counsel, and by what words are you speaking without knowledge? Now prepare yourself like a man, because I'm getting ready to ask you some questions. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Where were you when I determined its measurements? Where were you, watch this, where were you when I made the clouds a garment? Where were you when the morning stars were singing together, when the sons of God present? Where were you, Job? So here's what I want you to get out of that. Sometimes, watch this, life does not always happen as we planned it. In fact, most of the time, life won't happen as you planned it. Are you listening to me? However, God, in his sovereignty, still can orchestrate your life and help you get to your destiny. Can you say amen? Now, this is very important, especially in this church, because this is a faith church, a church that emphasizes faith, and we should, because the Bible says the just shall what? Live by faith. So look at someone, tell them, you have a part to play too. You have a part to play. myself here. Maybe I'm just preaching to myself. Got you covered by my blood. Somebody shout hallelujah. After all we do, we still have to trust him in our lives and allow him to be God in spite of what we're facing. We always have to trust him for his plan and destiny in our life. It's sort of like that story of the man who was a mountain climber in Argentina. He began to climb and he went high and he was climbing up there. And he made up in his mind, I'm going to climb this mountain and I don't want anybody to come with me. I'm going to do it myself. So he begins to tie the rope around him and he starts climbing up the mountain. And he's about 100 feet away from the top. And all of a sudden, the wind comes by and it almost knocks him off the mountain. But yet, because of his rope, he's able to hold on to the rope of the side of the mountain. And there he is, desperately holding on to the rope, looking at thousands of feet that, under him, knowing that, watch this, knowing that if God don't help him, he's going to die. All that pride went out the window. And he began to yell out, Lord, help me. Help me. God didn't answer. Then he screamed again as he got desperate, as he began to hold on. He said, Lord, help me. He got no answer. Then finally the rope began to slip and he felt like that was it. He was about to die. And he screamed out, Lord, help me. And God answered him. And the Lord answered him and said to him, let go. How many know you don't always like God's answers? But the story records that he would not let go and he held on. And one day later, when his buddies came to look for him, they found him frozen on the mountain holding on to that rope. And it frustrated and hurt them because what he did not know that there was a platform just 10 feet under him. That if he would have let go, he'd have landed on that platform, been able to warm himself up until the rescuers came. What is the moral of that story? That in life, you have to learn how to let go and trust God for the results. Oh, come on and shout. Come on. No matter how difficult it looks, that's called trusting his sovereignty. So we have to learn, and it's a learning curve, how to surrender to his sovereignty and to just trust him in our lives and to trust him that our entire life is in his hands. When you come to the altar and you give your life to the Lord, you hear me say this often. In this church, I say to people, ask God to forgive you and to receive him. And I pray for them and I tell them that when you receive God, receive Christ, you're receiving him for your past, your present, and your future. He said, I will never leave you. Somebody shout hallelujah. Now, Pastor Ken, why is this important? I'm going to get to this. This is very important. Two things happen when we refuse to trust his sovereignty or his plan to rule and govern our lives despite satanic interference and human intervention. Two things happen. We start living by our regrets. We live our lives governed by regrets. Regrets now are unavoidable. You can't avoid regrets. No, you can't. They are unavoidable, but we don't have to be ruined by them or governed by them. And this is what happens when you don't trust the sovereignty of God. You ask yourself questions like, why did it happen to me? Why did it not happen to them? Lord, why this family? Why was I born on this side of the tracks? And some people even go as far as saying, Lord, why am I this color? You begin to ask, Lord, why didn't I stay in there a little longer? Why did I leave too soon? Why did he leave me with the kids? And, And you start asking then, how did I lose that job that I put 25 years in? How did I lose this child? How did my father, why was he never there? You just start living life with regrets. How come and why not me? And before you know it, you're now every day being governed by your regrets. Now the problem with being governed by your regrets is that, watch this, it becomes toxic and it keeps you from receiving God's next. When you live by regrets, because all of us have them, but you don't have to be governed by them, you begin, if you're not careful, to receive according to your past. Now, that's a problem, because whenever you bring her into a new relationship, whenever you take him and what he did to you into a new relationship, see, living by regrets becomes even toxic in your relationships. Are you following me? When you come from a church where a pastor hurts you, and you bring that to dream life, I ain't your pastor. I ain't the pastor that hurt you. But because you're living by regrets, you can't receive God's next. Look at somebody and tell them, God has a next for my life. Oh, you do know that where you are, that ain't it. You do know that what you're looking at, that ain't it. Oh, can I talk to some people that really believe that God has a next in my life? He has a plan for my life of greater. He's able to do the exceeding and abundantly of all that may ask or think. Can I get about 50 people that can praise God for what's coming next? That he's not going to leave me in this pain. He's not going to leave me in this struggle. He's not going to leave me in this fear. He's not going to leave me in the disappointment. Come on. They have had some things happen that I wish really didn't happen to me, but I can't live by that, because all things are still working together for the good. So I'm not going to live by regret. I'm going to be governed by my future. Somebody shout hallelujah. Never let your past dictate God's plan for your future. Somebody shout hallelujah. Can I just get somebody to say, God, I thank you for something marvelous, something awesome, something I can't even figure out on my own. That's next on your agenda. That's why Paul said, watch this. That's why Paul said, if this one thing I do a lot of things. I minister throughout Asia Minor, but this one thing I do, I've written a lot of letters to the church, but this one thing I make sure that I do, and I keep on doing. What is it? I forget those things which are behind, and I'm reaching to those things that are in my future. Somebody shout hallelujah. I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. In other words, God got something better and greater for me. Can you give God about a 30-second praise and say, God, thank you that my past cannot hold me. Thank you that you will not base my future on what happened to me. Come on, give him a shout. We lose our expectancy. Ain't nobody going to ever love me. And I don't know where I can find anybody to love me like he loved me. Are you kidding me? Are you seducing God's sovereignty to your finite mind? God can create a man tomorrow if he wants to. And you won't even know where he came from. Is he sure? Oh, listen to this. When we lose our expectancy. This is important, Father. You can see how all this ties in. We lose our expectancy to receive God's next. And sometimes you got to keep ignoring those thoughts of the past. Stop pressing rewind and start pressing forward. Look at somebody, tell them, press forward, press forward. Come on, pray. That's what's happening to your life today. You're going to press forward, because there are some things that God has preordained just for you. And I got good news for you. He has not changed his mind. But God, you don't know what happened. You don't know. I did that, and I should have been there, and I wish that didn't have. I need to help your faith this morning. There are some things that he preordained. He pre-appointed, watch this, and Romans says he predestined. And this we know, that all things work together for the good to those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose, for whom he foreknew. He also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he called. So God knew, watch this, that you were going to choose him. So watch this, so he called you. Now, don't try to figure it out, because he says, I knew you before you entered your mother's womb, which means you were here, or you were here or in existence before you were born. I pre-knew everything about you, so I called you, then I justified you, or I already called you righteous. Wow. See why you're having a problem receiving this? Because regrets of life will hinder you from believing what God says. He said, I've already justified you. And watch this, and these he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who? And you got, the boss got you pulling your hair out? And you don't want to eat because somebody's angry with you? Who? And you've been staying home for the last 2 weeks from church because Sister So-and-so didn't speak to you? Who? Who can be against us? That's why I like this event, because this event, the triumphant entry, is really a text of sovereignty. It is a text that depicts God's sovereignty. You can see it all. If you follow the movement of the text, you can see it from beginning, Matthew, the 20th chapter, how God, Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, has organized, he has strategized, and he has set his own stage. He knew it was Passover. And he knew, as the great historian, Jewish historian said, Joseph of Osiris, he knew that millions of Jews and people were going to come to Jerusalem. He set the stage. He knew it. He knew it. He knew that there everybody was going to come, and whatever happened, they were going to know he was coming. So just before he comes to Jerusalem, he looks at the disciples and says, I'm going to go into Jerusalem, and the chief Pharisees and scribes, they're going to kill me. They're going to bury me. But notice, on the third day, I'm going to rise again. That's power, boy. That's power. When you know they're going to kill you, and you still know you're going to get up at the same time. You know they're talking about you, you still know God's getting ready to promote you. That's y'all ain't saying that. That's power. He sets the stage, so he goes to a town called Bethage, which is really forbidden, because history records that only lepers, what they considered unclean, or people you didn't mess with, they were set aside in society. It was almost like an AIDS community, where everybody was afraid, because they felt like, because it was set up east of Jerusalem, and so in their mind, they believe that the wind went from the east to the west, so they set them in the east, they set them in the west, whereby the wind would not blow, because they believed the leprosy was contagious, so they would stay away from all the lepers. And that's the very place that Jesus goes. Because he's not afraid to go where no man has gone before. He will go first to those who nobody wants. He stops in Bethridge. He stops right there. And he ministers to a guy named Simon, and he raises, because Simon has, he has died, and God ministers, and he raises Lazarus from the dead, and he raises him up, and his fame is all over. But now he's in Bethage with a bunch of lepers. And he goes to the Mount of Olives. I want you to see him setting the stage, and he's walking, and he sees two disciples of his, and he says, "Hey, guys, I need you to go to Jerusalem. When you get there, you're going to see a donkey and you're going to see a colt. They're going to be tied up. When you go there, you're going to be asked." Can you see his sovereignty? "You're going to be asked, 'Why are you taking this donkey and colt?'" He said, "You're going to be asked by the owner." And so Luke says, just as he said, they went to loose the donkey and the colt, and the owner, the Bible says, the owner asked, "What are you doing? Why are you doing this?" And they simply answered, just like Jesus told them, "Because the Lord has need of them." No, watch this. No questions asked, no negotiation, no struggle, they take the donkeys away. Where would your life be today if you surrendered to God all the assets that he asked for in your life? No argument, because he's sovereign. The real deal was that they didn't own it anyway. The earth is the Lord's. But watch him. He's setting up the stage. He knows he's popular. He tells them, "Go in there." And so they grab the donkey, and they take their coats off, and they put their coats on the donkey. And as he's riding through, they take some of their other coats, and they place them on the ground. And then the multitude sees them doing this, because they think that something's about to happen. So they take the palms off the trees, and they're getting ready to lay it out for the master to come through. He's popular. That's why he comes, because he knows that everybody's going to be there. He's on CNN. He's on 60 Minutes. Jesus of Nazareth goes into a leper's community and raises one from the dead. He's popular. He's on every morning news show. He's covered by every magazine, Enterprise, Ebony. Are you listening to Rolling Stone? They're all, can you see Jesus' picture? He is popular. He is, no, he's in every newspaper, from USA Today to the Baltimore Sun to the Wall Street Journal. He is well known. He is popular. So he chooses this time to come. And the Bible says that he's walking, the people are following him now from Bethage. And as he's leaving, the scripture says that there were two blind men. And the Bible says they heard Jesus coming. They couldn't see because they had no vision. The first thing you got to do when you don't have no vision is have a sharpened ear. And the Bible says they heard that Jesus was coming through. All they did was just heard, because faith comes by hearing. God doesn't have to show you everything if you can just hear it. That's why the old prophet said, "I can hear the sound of the abundance of rains." You got to learn how to shout over what you hear. So much time. Y'all hear what I'm saying? So they begin to cry. They say, "Jesus, Jesus, have mercy on me. Have mercy, O son of David." They knew who he was. And when they begin to cry out desperately, the Bible says they shouted out. As they begin to shout, the Pharisees and those around us in the boat, "Cut that out. Y'all be quiet. We don't do that in this church. Making too much noise, acting the fool. Be quiet." And the Bible says that the more they told them to stop, the louder they yelled. "Jesus, have mercy on me, O thou son of David." They shouted. And this is not a Sunday for you to be quiet. When you really want something from God, you don't look and check with the person on the right or left before you shout and cry out to him. Is there anybody here that says, what I need from God, can't nobody in this church give it to me but Jesus? And if you really believe that, you will shout out this morning, shout, Jesus, have mercy. And the more they tell you to shut up, the louder you will scream. Because I need a miracle today. I need a breakthrough today. I can't see him like you can see him, but I know he's in the midst. And if I know he's in the midst, he's already done his part. Now it's time for me to do my part. And they shout. And the Bible says, after they shout, Jesus stopped. He got their attention. Can I tell you that the praise and shout you're going to give God this morning is going to get heaven's attention? God is about to stop what he's doing when he hears your praise this morning. If you need a miracle, if you want a healing, if you shout this morning, you will get his attention. He will stop all of heaven to bless you. Jesus, I need you. But he's still setting the stage. Because now they're following him. And we got a multitude of people following him. And then he stops at the Mount of Olives. And he's 2,700 feet high in the Mount of Olives. He's purposely setting the stage. Because everybody can see him. The lepers can see him. The blind men can see him. The multitude can see him. And you got to understand this. Whenever there's a celebration, there are always going to be some haters present too. So his haters saw him also. The stage is set. And now he begins to walk. Because I need you to understand that he wasn't just trying to get their attention just to get their attention. He was trying to seal the scripture before their eyes. And that's why Matthew 21:5 says, tell the daughter, as it may be, all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet saying, tell the daughter of Zion. Zechariah 9:9 actually says, tell Zion to rejoice greatly. Tell Zion to shout. Because her king is coming to you. But watch this. Because if you don't know the word, you'll miss how he's coming. He's not coming, according to Zechariah, in a white stallion horse like the Roman soldiers did. He's coming on a donkey. Because a donkey is symbolic of humility. Watch this, the anointing, the Messiah, is coming on humility. He's not going to come on a proud heart. It refers to humility, peace. And watch this, Davidic royalty. So he's purposely coming as a king. You remember Jeru, when they made him king, they threw the palm branches out there. And Jeru, as a king being coronated, walked through with the branches on the ground like a king. We remember King Solomon when he was coronated. The scripture says he came in through a donkey. So he clearly knows what he's doing. He's literally acting out the tradition of the ancient kings. Look at somebody say, he's setting them up. He wants them to understand that whatever God says, he follows through with his plan. Somebody shout. He wanted them to know that God always keeps his word. That's why the promises of God are yea and amen. Every time God has promised you something, say amen. Every time he's promised you something, you say yes, Lord. Because I'm here to tell you that as sure as he's promised it, it's going to come to pass. You may be in a prison. You may be in jail looking at me by internet. Wherever you may be, I'm here to tell you that whatever God promised, he has the power to bring to pass. He's not a man that he should lie. Neither is he the son of man that he should repent. Have he not said, and will he not do it? Has he not spoken, and will he not make it good? Is there anybody here that had to wait on the word? But the word will always come to pass. Somebody shout hallelujah. This morning, maybe you're holding on to the word. I want to tell you that if you hold on, God is about to bring his promise to pass. Somebody shout hallelujah. I don't know where I'd be today if he did not bring forth his promise. And I got this strange feeling in my spirit that if he did it before, he will do it again. Because his word is forever settled in heaven. It may not happen when you expect it to happen. It may not even happen the way you want it to happen. But as sure as God said it, it shall come to pass. Can I tell you something? I've got this thing in my spirit now that I'm going to see everything that God has promised me. All I got to do is believe his word. All I got to do is hold on to his word. So watch this now. I want to tell you why we shout. The Bible says that, watch this, the scripture says that the stage was set. Yeah, and now the scriptures were settled. And now the Lord's people can shout. Somebody shout. Why are you shouting? Because their king is coming. They're shouting because they know who he is and they know what he's able to do. They're shouting unto a savior. And the Bible says that they cried out, Hosanna, which means save now. You got to understand what's going on politically. They've been under the tyranny of the Roman Empire. They were under the tyranny of their oppressors. But they knew that if they cried out to the Lord, that he would hear their cry. So watch this. The stage is set. The scripture is sealed. And now the Lord's people are ready to shout. Can I speak to you today that the stage of your life is set? That the scripture is already settled. And all you gotta do now is shout for your king. Somebody give God a shout. Somebody give God a shout. Somebody give God a shout. Why do we shout? What did they shout? They shouted, save. Save us now. Save us right now. We can't wait till next week. We can't go another month under this oppression. But Lord, you are the king. You are the savior of the world. So we're going to shout unto God. And that's what they did. They shouted to a king. And can I tell you something? If you shout this morning to a king, everything in your life is about to turn around for your good. Somebody shout hallelujah. We shout, save. Save now. The Greek translation is save, Savior. They know who he is. But some of you are here this morning and you don't know who he is. Because if you knew who he was this morning, you would begin shouting right in your seat. Now, why do we shout? Because Psalms 118 is a messianic psalm. It is speaking of David's life becoming a king. Now watch this. And David said, I've had some rejection in my life. I've had some disappointment in my life. I ran from Saul most of my life. But today is my day. That's what he said. He said, the stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the corner. Can I talk to somebody this morning? I know you've been rejected. I know you've been the black sheep of your family. I know it seems like everybody has been blessed before you.
But God told me to tell you that your rejection has only been an indicator that you are God's selection, that he has chosen you. I need you to give God a shout because you are next. I say you are next in line for the blessing. Somebody shout yes. Somebody shout yes. Can I preach like I feel? So David was speaking messianically. Now watch this. Even though it was applying to David's current life, it was prophetically for the future. He saw the Messiah coming into Jerusalem as a king. So watch this. He saw himself coming in, and then prophetically he saw Jesus coming in. And Jesus came in just like he saw it. Now today, historically, we saw Jesus come in. But prophetically, he's coming right here today. You said, how do you know that? Well, it goes on to say, rejoice. Give God your best praise. He says, for this is the day. This is the day. This is the day. What God's going to do, he's going to do it right now. According to your faith, according to your shout, he says, this is the day. Watch the sovereignty that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice. What are you saying, Pastor? Can no demon stop what God's about to do in your life? Can nobody hinder what God's about to do? He says, I'm getting ready to shout. Somebody shout Hosanna. Shout Hosanna. Shout Hosanna. Watch this. What are you shouting? Lord, save me. Can I tell you, if you were shout this morning, God told me to tell you, he's going to save people today from themselves. He's going to save them from their habits. He's going to save you in your finances. He's going to save you from your past. If you were shout Hosanna, if you were shout Hosanna, save now. I need a blessing now. I need a breakthrough now. I need a miracle now. I can't wait till next week. I can't wait till next month. This is the day. This is my season. This is my victory. This is my victory. Somebody shout. Shout for your children. Shout for the salvation of your children. Shout for your family. Shout for your marriage. Shout for your sickness. Shout for healing. Shout. I'm done.
To worry what tomorrow's gonna bring.
It'll be all over. Come on, everybody, come on.
It will be all over in the morning.
One more time. Ain't no need to worry. He's got my.
Ain't no need what tomorrow. It will be all over. It will be all over in the morning.
If you're here this morning, just give us a few moments. I know we're running a little late this morning, but follow me this morning. Somebody has to make a decision. Somebody has to make a decision. You're going to have to give it all to Jesus. You're going to have to trust your life into his hand. Shh. Every head bow, every eye closed. If you're here this morning, I'm only going to make an appeal to two people real quickly. But don't leave out of this service today without saying yes. Without saying yes. If you're here this morning, you say, Pastor Ken, I just need to get my life right with God. I need Jesus. If you're young, I want you to come. If you're middle-aged, I want you to come. If you're a senior citizen, I want you to come. Because this is the most important part of this service, is where you make a decision. Decisions are the gateways to breakthrough. The second people that I want to talk to is those of you that are here and you said, well, Pastor Ken, I'm saved, but I really believe I could learn in a church like this. I really believe I can grow. And I've been searching for a church home where I can really get fed, where I can really grow. But we're not the only church you can go to heaven from, but we're certainly one of them. And you will grow and be stretched in this church. And you will see the glory of God. If I'm talking to you, every head bowed, every eye closed, don't you look at anyone around you, because this will be the most important Sunday of your life if you say yes. Pastor Ken, I have not been living like I should. I need to receive Jesus today. I need him to come in. I need him to save me now. Or are you here and you say, Pastor Ken, I'm saved. I love the Lord, but I don't have a church home. I want to join this church today. I'm not going to procrastinate on prompts, and I'm coming today. They're coming already. I haven't even made the appeal. At the count of three, just come walking. One, two, three. Just walk. Come on. Just keep walking. Just come on. Come on, come on, come on.